About, you know, the history of your work, how you got to this point, your practice and process, and, you know, what informs the work that you...
Okay. Years and years and years and years and years ago, when I was a kid, there was a place called St. Martha's House. St. Martha's House was a settlement center. And what you had is you had access to a number of things. You could go there and you could learn to tap dance, you could go there, you could learn an instrument, you could go there and learn how to act in a play. But there was this one room in the back, which was this art room. And I would go back there and just draw. And drawing seemed to be very satisfying to me. Later on, maybe a few years later when I got older, there were a group of us who could all draw. And we used to draw in the street with chalk. Now that becomes significant later on. I didn't realize it, but it becomes significant later on. We would draw superheroes. And we'd see who could draw the best Superman, the best Captain Marvel, the best, I don't know, Submarine. There's a number of characters that no longer exist. From that, I got to be able to draw superheroes pretty well. I mean, I could draw. So there were two of us, a guy by the name of Horace Lovett and myself. Horace was better than me. Horace was better than everybody. The interesting thing is that when we went to high school and we took art, and when we graduated, I competed for a scholarship at the Academy and got it. He had to go to work because his father had passed. That's always been a kind of sadness for me because the guy was good. I mean, he was better than anybody. He could draw better than anybody. When I got to the Academy, I was absolutely intrigued by what I saw. I was intrigued with the process of learning to draw. I had to unlearn a lot of things that I thought I had learned. The result of that is that I became a very realistic painter. And my point is that I wanted to paint things that I knew. And so my dad was a minister, and so I would do drawings. Now, mind you, I'm sitting in church, right? And I'm supposed to be listening to the sermon. I'm drawing little drawings. ultimately, that began to develop into a way of composing compositions. I would go to storefront churches, I would go to emergency rooms and draw characters and then put them in particular environments. After I went to the Academy and I won a Crescent, which allowed me to travel to Europe, I was a very young man, actually a very young black man, who went to Europe, and I came back a very changed man. I saw things I thought I would never be able to see. I did things I thought I would never be able to do.
How old were you when you went to?
20. Here. And the response to me was different than it was here. So I came back a little bit of an angry man because I couldn't quite understand why things were so different here. As things continued, I continued to draw from what my experience had been within the black community, church, characters, people. I met this one guy walking down the street, and this very tall, lanky young man walked by. He was probably, and I don't want this to sound the way that it may sound, but he was startling. He was so unusual looking. I mean, you couldn't take your eye. He was ugly. Ugly in a way that he was absolutely beautiful. So I walked to him and I said to him, has anybody ever painted you? And he said, no. but his very deep voice. He was about 6'4". And he looked down at me and he said, no. And I said, well, do you mind if I? Would you mind posing? So we talked and he finally said yes. And I started this painting of him, which I finished. And it was him standing in front of a brick wall with his arms folded. And behind, I put no parking. You know, because people really had a difficult time with him. I gave that painting away to someone. And I lost track of it. Now, this is why it becomes, I guess, the painting itself becomes important. 25 years later, I received an email from a gallery in Boston who asked me if this was my painting. And he said, are you Mo Brooker? And I said, yes, because I wanted to know where that painting was. At US Artists, which is this thing that used to go on from time to time from the Academy, his gallery was coming down, and I asked, could I come over and see the work? So I went over and saw the painting, and I said to him, I will trade you any painting that I have for this. And he said, well, let me think about it. You know, that was 5 years ago. He hasn't decided yet, but he said he's still open. After I finished the Academy, after I came out of the Army and painted during the day and worked at a place called Philco Ford at night, making televisions, I grew weary of doing the figure. Not that the figure is easy, but more or less that it became less, I was less involved with the thought process behind doing the figure. And so it was less challenging. I could do it well, I could draw well, I could paint well, but I wasn't thinking. And so I said to myself, well, you know, you might as well just give up painting. And I decided I was gonna do that. So what I did is I decided to do away with all the work and all the materials that I normally use, like oil paint. And I decided to use a material that I had never used before, and that was pastel. I'd never used pastel before. And I began to use pastel in my way, which was not light and cross-hatching, very highly saturated surfaces, and very large. The largest piece I did was probably, it was called Afternoon Delight. And it was about 10 feet high and maybe about 6 or 7 feet wide. That then led me into looking for other materials, and so I looked into oil pastel and began to work with that for a bit, and then I looked into oil stick, which is pigment, resin, and wax, which then led me into encaustic, which I use off and on with painting, or sometimes totally by itself. I began to paint, went to graduate school, came out of graduate school, and went to the University of Virginia. And was there for a few years, and then went to the University of North Carolina. And was there for a while. I had never lived in the South. My parents were in the South. I wanted to know what it was like. So I did. After about 5 years, I was tired of the South. And so I came back up, and curious things happen to me, and I sometimes don't know how they happen. I just say that I'd never say that I'm lucky, because I don't believe in luck, but I believe I am blessed, and I'll tell you why. Came back to Philadelphia, wasn't teaching, received a call from the Cleveland Institute of Art. And they said to me, we've seen your work. Someone has suggested that we look at you as a teacher. Would you send us some information? Send our information off. Went up there and got the job. So I was in Cleveland for 10 years. And during that time, the work really grew and really changed. I went from being a semi-abstract painter to fully abstract. And the issue was, and I still do it, is that I use all the principles and ideas and concepts that I use as a figurative painter to compose. Much of what I compose is based on the golden section, which I think is probably one of the most wonderful compositional devices you can find. I use it. It works for me. I use issues of space. I use issues of rhythm. One of my favorite painters is, in fact, Rubens. Rubens' sense of rhythm, how he ties composition together, becomes significant to me. The persons who became probably the most influential to me, and still are, with Kandinsky's book on point, line, to plane, and concerning the spiritual, which is about color. I had never studied color. The academy didn't teach color, and when I got to graduate school, no one was teaching me color. So I decided to find out about color myself, and in reading these books, particularly concerning the spiritual, began to learn issues of color and began to do some experimentation with color for myself, and develop my own sense of color. And in fact, my graduate thesis, in a sense, challenged Alber's theory. Alber's deals with a static shape in order for his theory to work. If you introduce the curve, it doesn't always work. So that was the premise. I would put colors together that probably people wouldn't expect to be put together at all, but I would put them together because they worked for me. And initially, my paintings were thought to be very garish, as someone told me. Then the response changed. The other person is Gorky. Gorky for me lives, and for me, he is better than de Kooning and all the rest. Gorky knew, and whether they will admit it or not, many of them were influenced by Gorky in terms of what he did. Gorky used nature and figurative elements to compose his compositions, which is exactly what I do very much. I may draw a series of hands, and those hands will develop into a composition of some sort. I do something every spring. Depending on the rainfall, the snowfall, colors change in terms of the plants. When there's a lot of rain, the color is lush, and you see new tonalities of color. And when they're not, when it doesn't have very much rain, the colors are usual. I go out and look and see what the colors are and make notes to myself about what those colors are. Written notes in terms of what I should mix in order to make colors. So nature still remains for me a major influence, even though I don't paint directly from nature. The influence of nature in terms of what it does and what I see is important. I'll give you an example. If you take a texture that you find in nature, right, and you put it in a different context, it becomes new. And consequently, I can take a texture that is grass, put it somewhere else, and it becomes new. It is no longer grass, it is something else. And so in that sense, I continually learn from nature. Sometimes in the in the summer, late summer, at a certain time of day, probably around 4 o'clock, 3-4 o'clock, when you drive through the park and you see trees, you'll see these layers. And sometimes what you'll see is you'll see a dark, and behind that dark is a light. And then other times, you'll see the light and behind it is a dark. I sometimes use that principle just in terms of composing. So nature remains for me a very influential partner for me. I can't imagine doing anything that you think is out of your own head. You can't make up, you simply rearrange things that you've seen in different relationships. That's all that you really do. You don't, you know, a lot of students say, well, I can't make this up. And I say, you're right, you can't. You know, but think about something that you understand and then let's turn it around and put it in some different relationship or some different capacity. And you'll find that it becomes very, 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 very different and new, you know. Mm-hmm. So going along the, I mean, I've painted for about 40 years. and I still am learning. I mean, that's the thing that's so exciting. I'm still learning about painting. I'm surprised many times about what paint can do and what I thought it could do and then what I find out that it can do beyond that. So it's, I come into my studio and I enjoy myself being here. I put my music on. I have my, well, in the summer, I have my coffee culata or my cup of coffee. And, you know, I'm here. I used to smoke. I smoked for about a long time. The reason why I stopped using pastel is because between the smoking and the dust of pastel, I found myself beginning to cough and I had no breath. And that's when I decided I would go into pastel, oil pastel, other media that would let me get away from the dust.
Now, did you quit smoking at the same time or was that?
I stopped smoking and I didn't come to my studio for 6 months.
Wow.
Because smoking, very much a part of the whole process that you come. I would come in, and that's why I don't have coffee in here anymore. I'd come in, turn the coffee on, light up a cigarette, sit back, enjoy that smoke, get myself the coffee, drink, get up, do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 strokes, sit down, light myself up another cigarette and a cup of coffee. You know, I mean, it got to the point where I was smoking more than I was painting, and so. Health-wise, my daughter said to me, and I mean, this kills you, Daddy, won't you stop smoking? And I said, oh, man. I said, I have to do this. And so I came in the studio one day, because I used to have cartons, took the cartons, threw them away, put the cigarettes down, and never smoked again.
I know I've heard you say before that music is very influential in jazz.
Well, music is really important
Is that something that developed in that time in Cleveland when you were making that transition, or is that something that's been kind of prevalent throughout?
Music has been a part of my family. My older brother, Mitch, was a jazz musician. Everyone in the house played an instrument. I played the piano, Mitch played the piano. Arnold played the clarinet, Clifton played the trumpet, and so forth. Everyone sang. So music was really, really, really important. When you get inside music, you begin to see the relationships and the parallels, not only to life, but in terms of what you do, in terms of movement, in terms of your mood, how you feel. So I started looking at music, two forms of music, which I still find exciting. One is gospel. I mean, I find gospel probably the most innovative music out there today. I like jazz, but I like only certain areas of jazz. I don't like fusion. I'll listen to it, but I don't like fusion. I like bop. Bop, in its purest form, for me, is about the process of making decisions. Bop musician sits there, and it's an intimate music, and you're playing, and in order to respond, you've got to listen as a musician, and your response is based on what you're hearing, what the others are playing, and your ability with your instrument. And in that moment, out of millions of options, you choose one, and it's the right one. And so that caused me to realize that impulse, which a lot of people think jazz is, has nothing to do with spontaneity. Spontaneity is different. It is an instantaneous recognition and decision. It is not, oh, I'll do this. Not at all. And so jazz is based on that. The other issue that became important to me, which is why I probably do a lot of things to both Charlie Parker and to Coltrane, is Parker just turned music around. Jazz, as you come through the 40s, began to deal with substitute chords, 7th, 5th, 9th, which not necessarily were being used in music, popular music. The other issue about Parker is that Parker would do anything that he wanted to do. He could play in and out and around the range, the chord structure, as long as he resolved it at the end of the passage. Now, that became significant for me. It opened it up for me as in terms of abstraction. I could do anything I wanted to do as long as I resolved that issue in terms of the painting itself. And so that became, for me, a major issue. In the earlier works, line became melody, as far as I was concerned. And shape became passage. And within a passage, you'll find a lot of structure, chordal structure. And so I would build the paintings in a way that would start from the farthest layer and come forward, not from the surface. Because that deals with details. That's why line became, in many cases, the last element that I would put on a painting, because it was detail-oriented. And so, various things began to happen. You see stripes and diagonal lines and things like that. That comes from an earlier time when the painting was looked more geometric. And bands were used as a containing element. Then they began to break up, and that kind of signified my own sense of freedom and relief from issues. And so the result is that slowly iconography began to happen for me. Images began to take root, and I would throw things away and invent new kinds of images. Painters from the past that have influenced me, again, as I said, Rubens was enormously important for me. The artist in the studio, painted by Vermeer, it is an absolute compositional, perfect painting. I mean, the way that you step across this initial chair, and the way he paints it, so it doesn't cause a barrier, but it causes you to hesitate, then you step over and you hit the floor. And the floor, the pattern on the floor, takes you into the artist, which takes you up into his hand, into the painting, and then ultimately to the figure which is way in the back. So compositionally, I use the checkerboard a lot, simply because it makes sense compositionally for me. And it's an admiration of Vermeer. So that in my work you'll find a lot of tipping of the hat to a number of artists of the past, which most people would not think are there in terms of what I do. So for me, the issue of painting is almost about, and I say this and people kind of look at me. But it's a form of worship for me. I mean, everyone has their own way of doing it. I happen to think that I've been given a talent of some sort. And in recognition of that talent, and in recognition of what I consider to be a higher being, I find that in my studio, really wonderful things happen. And I really can't explain it, but things that seem almost relative to worship begin to happen. I sign all my paintings at the end with TTGG. And that means to the glory of God. That's what it means. I don't apologize for it. If somebody else doesn't believe it, that's good, that's fine. I don't ask you to believe that. I do. And so I know that such a being exists for me. Now for other people it may not, but for me it does. And so consequently, it is a form of worship for me to come into the studio and to use that ability that I've been given to talk about things that I think are important.